Good afternoon to you. We will continue with the Constitution. Central-state relations, second part. In central-state relations, we started administrative relations. In the last class, we have seen the initial part of administrative relations. We have noted specifically how the Articles 355, 256, 257, 365 and 356 are interlinked and how one article leads to another. There is therefore no way that a state government can refuse to comply with the provisions of any central law. This is very clear from the provisions of the Constitution. Now, we will see the rest of the articles governing administrative relations. What are those articles? Those are Article 258, Article 258A, Article 260, Article 261, Article 263, etc. We will see one by one. It is very easy. I will make you understand as easily as possible. Article 258 deals with mutual delegation of functions. Mutual delegation of functions between the state and the center. One way is by way of agreement between the union and the state, an agreement. Second is by legislative action without the consent of the state. So, kindly remember, one is by way of agreement, both state and the union both agree. Second is by legislative action of the union. Remember, state cannot ask the, by law, state cannot ask the union to do it. It is only union can ask the state. Kindly remember this point. Now, first point, that is been in agreement with the consent of both. The President of India. Who? With the President of India. With the consent of the Governor of the state. So, who are involved? President of India. With the consent of the Governor of the state. Can entrust. Either conditionally or unconditionally, either to the state government or its officers or immaterial. That is all extension of the clarification. President of India, with the consent of the governor of the state, can entrust any function on which the executive powers of the union extends. Any function on which executive powers of the union extend, they can be entrusted to the union by consent. So again I repeat, President of India, number one, with the consent of the governor of the state, number two, can entrust any function on which the executive powers of the union extends. To whom? To the state government or its officers. Is there any condition? No. Either conditionally or unconditionally. So, there should be no doubt on this point. Second, similarly, I told you two. One is mutual agreement, another is by law. Similarly, a parliamentary law can confer the powers and duties upon the state government or its officers with reference to any matter on which the state has no powers to make law. Again, I repeat. A parliamentary law may confer the powers and duties upon the state government or on its officers with reference to any matter which the state has no powers to make law. So the state does not have any power means it is not coming under the state law or it is not under the concurrent law. So, in that case, the parliamentary law can be made conferring the powers and duties upon the state government or its officers with reference to any matter on which the state has no powers to make law. So remember, 258 deals with two items. One is mutual agreement and the other is by legislative action. So there should be no doubt on this ground. Secondly, in nutshell, let us say in nutshell, either the center can ask the state by mutual agreement to discharge the duties of the union, or the state can be compelled by the union through a parliamentary law to undertake the function relating to the matters in the union list. I have only clarified the article 258. Now we are coming to article 258A. First 258, now 258A. Here, the governor of the state, who is initiating? The governor of the state, with the consent of the union government, remember, not president. Here is the petty question. Under article 258A, which was added to 77th Amendment Act 1956, the governor of the state, with the consent of the union government, may entrust either conditionally or unconditionally to the union government or its officers any function in relation to any matter to which the executive power of the state extends. So here, remember, in the first two cases I said union function. Here the state function. State function, again I repeat, the governor of the state with the consent of the union government, not president, PT point of view, may entrust any function in relation to any matter to which the executive power of the state extends. So state executive powers can also be given to the union or its officers, either conditionally or unconditionally. This is article 258A. Remember, this is article 258A. Now comes to 260. What does it mean? What does the article 260 speak about? It speaks about the jurisdiction of the union on the territory of a foreign country. Remember, foreign country, what is the extent of jurisdiction of our union on the territory of a foreign country? Remember, under this article, the union government, number one, by agreement with the government of the foreign territory, see, in agreement with the government of the foreign territory, may undertake any legislative action, any executive action, or any judicial action vested in the government of such a territory, but such agreement shall be subject to any law made by the parliament. So, very simple, very easy to understand that the union government initiative comes from union government. In agreement with the government of the foreign territory, may undertake any function, all the three wings, legislative function, judicial function, or executive function, in the government of, which is vested in the government of such territory, but such agreement shall be subject to any law relating to the exercise of foreign jurisdiction for the time being in force. Remember, foreign territory only regulated by the law made by the parliament. So, this is okay. Now we are coming to 261. This is dealing about the cooperation between the union and the state. This article enjoins that full faith and credit shall be given throughout the country for all public act, records and judicial proceedings of the union and every state. Remember, we have 28 states and 9 union territories. So the state governments are different. But if any one state government has given an order, it has to be respected by all. There is no question of, no, this is Tamil Nadu government has given, so I will not obey. Or this Punjab government has given, the Punjab is always against us, so we will not obey. No, that is not the question at all. This article clearly says that full faith and credit shall be given throughout the country for all public act, public record, and all judicial proceedings of the union and every state. Suppose, let us say, a person is, committed a murder. So, he is available in Gujarat. So, the law extends. The FIR might have been filed in Tamil Nadu. But the fellow is in Gujarat. Let us say, why? The public act, record, judicial jurisdiction of the union and every state shall be given full faith and credit throughout the territory of India. Here, one more thing you should know. Final judgment delivered by the civil court in any part of the country shall be liable for execution anywhere within the territory of India. Remember, only civil proceedings and not criminal proceedings. Let us say Tamil Nadu, let us say Gujarat government has punished a person under Prohibition Act. The fellow is coming under to Tamil Nadu. You cannot take action. That is not permissible. He has been punished in the Gujarat government. So he has come to Tamil Nadu. So this is applicable only in respect of civil proceedings, not for criminal proceedings. Remember. Now we are coming to Article 262. Very, very important. Very important. Why it is important? It speaks about adjudication of disputes relating to the water of interstate rivers and interstate valleys. It talks about the rivers of water of the interstate rivers and interstate valley. What does it say? Parliament may by law provide adjudication of any dispute with regard to the use, distribution and control of water of any interstate rivers or any interstate river valley. Who can make law? Only Parliament. Most importantly, remember, Parliament may law, by law, preclude the Supreme Court or any other court from exercising any jurisdiction on the matters. So, I told you, the original jurisdiction will not apply to under Article 131 proviso. This is the one. That is, on the basis of Article 262, the Interstate Water Dispute Act 1956 has been enacted and it has excluded the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court in respect of a water dispute which has been referred to the tribunal. So, Water Dispute Act, Interstate Water Dispute Act 1956 has excluded the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court with regard to the water dispute which has been referred to the tribunal. Very, very important under Article 262 of the Constitution. And you know, Article 259 has been deleted through 7th Amendment Act 1956. Now we are coming to Article 263, which speaks about the coordination between the states. Under this provision, President may establish what is known as Interstate Council in Public Interest. What does it mean? 263, Interstate Council. Who can appoint? The President of India. What is the main duty? To inquire into the dispute between the states and advise them accordingly. It will also investigate and discuss the subjects in which the states and the union, or states plus union on the one side and the other side, the other states, has a common interest. The nature of duties and organization and procedure shall be stipulated by President. Remember, here Parliament is not involved. Most important, 263, Parliament is not involved. Who is initiating? President of India. It is a coordination between the states. Under this, interstate council will be established. What for? In public interest. What is the duty? To inquire into the disputes between the states and the states and advise them, and also to investigate certain subjects which are of common interest between the states and the union or states intersea. This is the role of Interstate Council under Article 263 of the Constitution. Remember, now we are coming to what is known as All India Services. Very important. You are going to appear for that All India Service Examination. Under Article 312, All India Service, Article 312. You know, there is a federal government, and that is the union. And simultaneously, there are provinces, that is the states. So, normally, it is expected that there should be only two services. One is central service to take care of the union government, and another is state service to take care of the state government. Now, in India, there is a peculiar situation that there are one more additional service known as All India Services. Remember, Dalhousie said, India cannot be ruled by sitting in Delhi. India can be ruled only from the villages. So, the establishment and administration should go to the village and rule the country. Accordingly, this All India Service, Cornwallis and Dalhousie, they established and it has been promoted. And remember, what are the composition of All India Services? Indian Administrative Service, Indian Police Service, and Indian Forest Service. Don't say Foreign Service, Forest Service. Indian Administrative Service under the control of the Department of Personnel and Training, Indian Police Service under the control of Ministry of Home Affairs, Indian Forest Service under the control of Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. Remember, who are recruiting All India Service members? It is recruited by UPSC. Who is controlling them? Department of Personnel. They are sent to the state. They are recruited by the union, controlled by the union, but their services are utilized by the state. They are allocated to the cadre. They are allocated to the states. And the states utilize their services. Who are paying them? The states are paying them. Remember, but to whom they will be loyal, more loyal? Only with the cabinet secretary and the central government. Why? Because they are ambassadors of the union for the states, and they are working in the state. They are allocated to the cadre, to the states. They work there, gain experience, field experience, and come back to the center on tenure system. 7 years they will be in the center, and after gaining experience of All India policy formulation, they will again go back to the state for administration. So, they are ambassadors, they ensure coordination, the highest administrative caliber. Every All India Service officers have highest caliber of what is known as administrative acumen, and they are best administrators and best coordinators, and they know how to plan, how to implement, how to ensure. They know the pulse of the people. They are on the field, so they know very well. Similarly, this Indian Forest Service was created in 1966. Initially, in 1947, it is Indian Civil Service. Subsequently, it was split into two. That is, one is Indian Administrative Service and Indian Police Service. Initially, it is called Indian, what is called Imperial Police. That was converted into Indian Police Service. Indian Forest Service was created as an All India Service in 1966. Okay, now how this is created? Another important point from the PT point of view. Remember, many people will immediately say, under Article 312 by Rajya Sabha resolution, All India Service is created. No, kindly understand, All India Service is created only by Parliament. Who creates? Parliament creates. How? It is on the basis of a supportive resolution passed by Rajya Sabha by 2/3 majority of the members sitting and voting. So, Rajya Sabha resolution cannot create All India Service. Rajya Sabha resolution is only a supportive resolution on the basis of which the parliament will create All India Service. So, remember, second point, very often, very frequently we will say that it is 2/3 of the majority of the members present on voting. Don't say special majority. No absolute majority is essential. No absolute majority is essential. Who can create? Only Rajya Sabha. Only Rajya Sabha resolution. Remember, this is the unique power of Rajya Sabha. Lok Sabha has no role. Lok Sabha will come into picture only when it is created, when a law is made for creation of All India Service. The supportive resolution is the exclusive privilege of Rajya Sabha. Kindly remember, from the PT point of view, you should remember. All India Services violates the principle of federalism. Absolutely correct. Yes, it violates the principle of federalism. It restricts the autonomy of the state. But the All India Services are essential on the ground that they help to maintain high standards of administration, not only at the center, but also at the state. They help to ensure uniformity in administrative system and also ensure cooperation, coordination, and joint action on the issues of common interest of national importance between the center and the state. In addition to this, most important, in addition to this, we have dual polity, but there is no dual system of administration of justice. On the other hand, we have an integrated, unified judiciary, Supreme Court at the top, High Courts at the state level, both are at the control of the union. Both are at the control of the union. The judges of High Court are appointed by President in consultation with the Chief Judges of India and governors of the state. They can be removed and transferred by President of India. Parliament has the powers to establish common High Court for two or more states. Similarly, chairman and members of the State Public Commission are appointed by the governor, but they are removed by the President. Parliament can establish joint State Public Service Commission for two or more states at the request of the state legislature. The chairman and members of joint State Public Service Commissions are appointed by President and removed by President. Thus, almost everything in the control of the union is immense. On similar analogy, remember, state election commissioners are appointed by President but removed by President. We can always see that the Governor's Conference, is presided over by Union Home Minister. Chief Minister's Conference is presided over by Prime Minister. Chief Secretary's Conference is presided over by Cabinet Secretary. Vice Chancellor's Conference is presided over by Vice President. State Law Minister's Conference are presided over by Union Law Minister. The State Home Minister's Conference are conducted by Union Home Minister. The state ministers are officers have no role at all. That is why we say the states have become a glorified municipalities. Because otherwise it is not possible. You have to maintain some element of unification among the states which are in diverse nature. Thank you. We will end this. We will come to next is legislative relations or financial relations in the next class. Thank you.